I'd like to share a paragraph from my book, from an autobiographical chapter. This picks up after my undergraduate studies at George Mason and during my graduate studies at the New York University. I think it was during my second year at NYU that the Austrian Colloquium hosted Donald Deirdre McCloskey to present the Rhetoric of Economics article that had recently appeared. I was immediately taken with the paper and with McCloskey as a personality, thinker, and figure. I waxed about the book, The Rhetoric of Economics, in a review published by the Cato Institute, and I avidly mined the pragmatist tradition that McCloskey pointed to, especially William James and Richard Rorty. McCloskey's attitude of mere ethics, of broad learning, of candid purpose behind the better organized conversation we might call science, with a small s, of indifference towards strutting methodological precepts and of aversion to sectarianism, all the selfhood I was working on. And he, now she, was even libertarian. It all fit. McCloskey validated my selfhood and richly instructed and provided for its cultivation. Anyway, that's the end of the quote. That instruction has continued right down to today, not least with the teachings of her current multi-volume project that he just spoke of. I'm enormously grateful to Deirdre for all that she is doing and has done for me. And I thank all of you for coming out. Now, what I've got prepared is a kind of thematic presentation about certain ideas in the book, not anything like an overview. And the title is Allegory in Political Economy. So, Smith sketches an aspect of coordination. He says, this is in The Wealth of Nations, it is the interest of the people that their daily, weekly, and monthly consumption should be proportioned exactly as possible to the supply of the season. Now, how does this happen? Well, he talks about the grain dealer and his pursuit of profit and how he does things that conduce to such coordination. Without intending the interest of the people, he is necessarily led by regard to his own interest to treat them, even in years of scarcity, pretty much in the same manner as the prudent master of a vessel is sometimes obliged to treat his crew. When he foresees that provisions are likely to run short, he puts them upon short allowances. Though from excess of caution, he should sometimes do this without any real necessity, yet all the inconveniences which his crew can thereby suffer are inconsiderable in comparison to the danger, misery, and ruin to which they might sometimes be exposed by a less provident conduct. That's a miniature of a more well-known metaphor. The individual generally indeed neither intends to promote the public interest nor knows how much he is promoting it. And by directing that industry in such a manner as its produce may be of the greatest value, he intends only his own gain, and he is in this, as in many other cases, led by an invisible hand to promote an end which was no part of his intention. The prudent master is a simile. He actually says, like the prudent master. I think you'd say that the being whose hand is invisible is a metaphor. By extending a metaphor, it becomes allegory. Merriam-Webster defines it as an expressive style that uses fictional characters and events to describe some subject by suggestive resemblances and extended metaphor. I think that allegory is really important to economics, and in particular to the kind of economics that people like Smith and Hayek have practiced. Here's another example. The reason why it pays, as said Edwin Cannon, to do the right thing, to do nearly what an omniscient and omnipotent benevolent Inca would order to be done, are to be looked for in the laws of value. So he's likening what happens in the economy to what happens in a fairy tale, in an allegory, where somehow an Inca guides action, some Inca god. I want to elaborate an allegory, I think in line with the ones you just heard. Here's how it goes. Joy is this allegorical being whose hands are invisible. She is like a monotheistic god. She's universally benevolent, super knowledgeable, able to communicate personally with each individual. Individuals believe in Joy's benevolence and trust her knowledge and value her love and approval. This is the fairy tale we get to construct. That is the one I'm constructing. And what I want to suggest is that such allegory is actually latent in a lot of our conversation in economics, including some of the most important. Now, in this allegory, Joy communicates with Bridget the baker. She tells Bridget that perhaps she should buy new ovens, look out for better deals in flour, and advertise her confections. Joy communicates these instructions to Bridget. There is a meeting of minds between Joy and Bridget in this fairy tale. And the system is voluntary. Bridget is sensible to Joy's benevolence and ethical wisdom. She feels entrusted to advance what Joy finds beautiful. She generally follows, let us say, we get the right to create this allegory, she generally follows Joy's communications. The signals from Joy are embraced voluntarily from what Smith might call her sense of duty. Bridget enters, if I may say so, this is quoting Theory of Moral Sentiments, into the sentiments of that divine being. And those communications tell her to take actions rather like the actions that the market signals would lead her to take. And hence the parallel between the allegory and the market in real life. Now, back to the allegory, we have bona fide communication. Beholding by Joy of the coordination of the vast, oh, this should be vast concatenation, sorry, of the vast chain of activities, the economic activities. Cooperation writ large among the participants of the system. And if Joy were to give bad instructions, she would be erring. And she might then correct the error. So what's an example of econ talk where I think this is latent? Hayek's famous communication talk. This is just one example. We must look at the price system as such a mechanism for communicating information if we want to understand its real function. There are a number of very important Hayek quotes along these lines. And just to bring it up to date, our professors here, Tyler Cowen and Alex Tabarrok, say similar things in their textbook, Prices Are Signals. The high price of ice signals a profit opportunity. Price signals tell entrepreneurs what areas of the economy consumers want expanded and what contracted. But let's think about it. You go to Safeway and you see that eggs are marked $1.89. What literal communication is there here? Remember, there is actually communion in communication. And what real communion is going on here? In fact, I think the only thing that's literally being communicated by the price on the eggs is yours for $1.89. No one's communicating to you or anyone else that you should buy eggs or not buy eggs or invest in producing eggs or anything else like that. All right. The economic explanation of profit-seeking and prices entails communication only quite incidentally if you're literal about communication. Rather, it's primarily allegorical when Cowen and Tabarrok or Hayek say this. They're actually, I think, referring to an allegory and the communication like I described between Joy and all of the participants and drawing that as a parallel to what happens in the market. Hayek early on actually addressed this kind of problem. This was in a 1933 paper. The spontaneous coordination of individual efforts has never been given a title which would secure it an adequate and permanent place in our thinking. The limitations of language make it almost impossible to state it without using misleading metaphorical words. The only intelligible form of explanation for what I'm trying to state would be to say, as we say in German, that there is sense in the phenomenon. that they perform a necessary function. It goes on, but as soon as we take such phrases in a literal sense, they become untrue. It is an animistic, anthropomorphic interpretation of phenomena, the main characteristic of which is that they are not willed by any mind. And as soon as we recognize this, we tend to fall into an opposite error. We deny the existence of what those terms are intended to describe. And it's that last part that I think is particularly significant, because I take him there to be saying, don't fall into the error of denying allegory, which is exactly sort of in line with my thrust here, that I think we should recognize and declare allegory, and even elaborate it, so that we get straight in our own head what we mean when we say stuff like communication through the price system. And here he also talks a little bit in his vein, which suggests a sort of allegorical being. I'll skip that one. It's valuable to talk this way, and that's one reason we want to salvage or support talking this allegorical way. It enables us to ask, what are the relevant signals? How do they conduce to the general interest? How do they adjust when prices go wrong? If the signals start telling people to go in the wrong direction, will the system correct itself? Will the system tend to keep up with changes? Will it dig up new opportunity, new manners for communication? All of these are great questions that are really valuably answered, but they're all part of this communication allegory. Coordination also fits in here. In the pin factory, the spectator, as Adam Smith put it, can actually see the concatenation before his eyes. One man draws out the wire, the next one cuts it, the next one grinds it at the top for receiving the head, and so on. And you actually see the coordination right in front of you. Simon Newcomb talked about it within the firm that way. But a little later, guys like Hayek and Coase took it beyond the firm. And in that case, who beholds the vast concatenation, economy-wide concatenation? In the firm, we can imagine the owner or the manager, and we can even guess pretty well at what the criterion for coordination would be in the pin factory. The criterion for coordination would be the honest profit of the pin factory. The more profit the pin factory makes, the better coordinated its concatenation is. But when we take that same idea beyond the firm and go to, as it were, the whole world economy, first of all, who is the beholder? And what is the criterion for coordination? And I think what we actually are doing is imagining a beholder, whether we realize it or not, like the joy allegory I just suggested. And this sentence, I think, kind of has that flavor. Prices, said Hayek, can act to coordinate the separate actions of different people in the same way as subjective values help the individual to coordinate the parts of this plan. To Joy, all of those different prices and so on are all parts of her plan. Cooperation is another term that plays an important role in economics, and especially in classical liberal economics. Here I quote Bastiat, Henry George, Wittgenstein, Milton, Rose Friedman, and again Cowan and Pavarot to bring it down to today, all saying that the economy is a great system of cooperation. And that's a very important message if, as it were, you want people to accept market exchange and the worldwide system. But again, does it make sense literally, or does it depend on allegory? Hayek said, cooperation, like solidarity, presupposes a large measure of agreement on ends as well as on the methods employed in their pursuit. It makes sense in a small group whose members share particular habits, knowledge, and beliefs about possibilities. In other words, literally, he's kind of giving a literal definition of cooperation. It doesn't particularly make sense to say that, you know, the people in Indonesia who helped put this screen together cooperated with me. I don't know who they are. You know, there was many people involved. yes, there was little moments of cooperation between the different people who helped put this thing together, but there was a lot of instances of non-cooperation. There was a lot of instances of competition. I'm sure there were instances of people being misled and just doing their routine tasks and a whole lot of things. There's no real reason to say that it was cooperation particularly that brought this to us unless we invoke something like the Allegory. Then we could say that all of the folks in the allegory are queuing off joy, kind of like the players queue off the quarterback who cooperate in winning the football game. All the people in the allegory queue off joy and actually have a sense of helping to advance and have a common knowledge that everyone else, too, in the allegory is helping to advance what joy finds beautiful. So again, I think it's actually allegory, mainly, that sustains that important thought of the market system as cooperation. And similarly for market error and correction. Error entails a sense of regret. And loss-making firms have not always necessarily erred. They might just feel like a poker player that they made a good bet and drew a bad beat. That's not really making an error. And if and afterwards when the player gets on the rail, right, to Shauna Hyatt or somebody interviews them and says, what do you think of that bad beat? What do they say? That's poker. Okay? Sometimes you lose not because you err. And in fact, it could be that many of these entrepreneurs who end up making losses and losing out to their competitors might not really feel that they erred. So in what sense was it an error for those activities to be expanded and invested in when they did not make profits? Well, I think it's essentially, again, the allegory. If joy were to have told, say, Borders bookstores to expand the way they did, and joy knew about Amazon and developments, she would feel that she had erred. She would feel a sense of regret in guiding activity that way. So this whole idea of market error and correction, I think, again, is actually best understood as allegorical. And it goes also for policy error and correction. In fact, public choice economists make a point of explaining that the policymaker is not necessarily erring. The reviewer at the FDA who has to decide whether or not to permit this new drug sees that they have these incentives and that if it turns out to be a bad drug, they're going to catch a lot of trouble. And they don't necessarily regret the bad policy, essentially, that they put in. What do we mean by bad policy? Bad in joy's eyes. And so we still talk about the policy as error, even though agent error may not particularly be part of why it happened. And so again, I think we're actually relying on allegory. So I've talked about communication, cooperation, error, and correction. I think there are other tropes that tacitly draw on allegory, like the economy and cost-benefit analysis. So let me finish by saying some of the reasons to recognize and declare allegory, assuming I'm right that we're doing that. This is coherent. There's problems when liberal economists deny allegory. They play into the role of one unattuned to the social, since after all, joy represents the social, okay? This, by the way, is very much in line with Adam Smith, where joy corresponds to the impartial spectator. I think the impartial spectator, the being whose hand is invisible, are essentially the same being. Liberal economists, though, nonetheless speak of coordination, cooperation, communication, and so on, and I think fall into the inconsistency and self-contradiction when they deny allegory. They can't actually sustain that talk with them. And hence, they subvert their own valuable teachings. Also, when they deny allegory, they relinquish the allegorical to those inclined to take it in illiberal directions. Liberals need to fight illiberal allegory, not with denials of allegory, but with liberal allegory. Other benefits from declaring allegory: making the allegory explicit helps to make it innocuous. You spell this out and you explain that joy, for example, has super knowledge, and in fact the ability to personally communicate with people, and it makes it clearer and clearer that it's not the government. The government's the last thing that can have this personal, candid communication with people. Plus, it does not have the knowledge. So rather than worrying about this being dangerous, I think that spelling it out helps, as I say, to make it innocuous. Also, in doing this, you confess the looseness of aspects of your analysis, particularly the basis by which joy finds things more beautiful. That's inevitably going to be the loose, vague, and indeterminate, or aesthetic, as Smith puts it. And then just a couple of final points of a slightly different nature. I think that allegory can, to some extent, help to answer in a liberal way the yearning for larger meaning and connection. The idea that by making honest profit, you are actually serving universal benevolence, as represented, as it were, by this allegorical being joy. You can have this sense of cooperation, even though you don't see the people who weigh downstream buy your products and benefit from them. But by virtue of the allegory, you can think about the way in which this is a kind of cooperation and a kind of fulfillment, which I think is really natural to people from our instincts. So it might, in some ways, answer that yearning. On the other hand, and that's this next point, allegory can help people to see that they must subdue or rechannel the yearning for larger meaning and connection. I think that liberal allegory can help to tell people why government's not the answer. And many people look to government and other large, powerful, permanent things for meaning and connection. They naturally glom on to the largest and most permanent and most powerful things they find around them. And that would particularly include the government. And I think that actually spelling all this out helps to, in some sense, discourage people from looking to government for this larger meaning and connection. This is my last slide. You don't know where you're going, you could end up somewhere else. So in the conclusion of my book, I talk about the arrival of the theory of moral sentiments, which is deeply, deeply allegorical, and how Dugald Stewart and others very quickly sort of pounced on it for being allegorical and rejected the allegorical elements and tried to make things more scientific. And this very point was picked up by others, for example, Alexander Bain. And TMS actually fell into oblivion fairly soon after Smith's time, and remained in oblivion. In other words, it was in oblivion during pretty much the whole following liberal era. It remained in oblivion really until the last 30 or 40 years, when it's been rediscovered. And I think that this might all kind of fit together in terms of what happened. Basically, again, after TMS, liberalism sort of turned its back on allegory, and then the world turned its back on liberalism. So I actually think that understanding this allegorical mode of thinking and basis for connecting and advancing liberal ideas and liberal values could be vital and could even help us understand why liberalism failed at the end of the 19th century, a failure that we've never recovered from. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Speech defect, you can adjust to it or run screaming from the room. It's your call. Although it would be very illiberal of you to run screaming from the room. Some of my best friends are illiberal, so. There's a lot in Dan's book, and I urge you to buy it and learn from it. I would call it by a new word that I want you all to adopt and learn to say. You know how you learn a new word? You use it in a sentence once a day. So I want you all, everyone in this audience, to learn to use the word humanomics every day. And what humanomics is a small group of economists who are trying to recover a Smithian attitude of the sort that Dan praises in the social sciences, and to stop trying over and over again to pretend we're the social scientist's vision of a physicist. It's come to irritate me very much when my colleagues in economics say, well, we're social physicists, we're tough guys, because it turns out they never know what they're talking about. They never know how physics actually works. What Dan is trying to do, in other words, as I am, and as I say a few others, is to combine quantitative thinking, the sort that would be associated with physical sciences, with categorical thinking, which we associate with the humanities. Good, bad, person, non-person. Those categories with which you can't do social science, if you're gonna calculate the population of Northern Virginia, you have to define where Northern Virginia is. You have to have a category of inside Northern Virginia and outside. And that combination of quantitative methods applied to qualitative starters, qualitative categories, is a humanistic economics. Or to put it another way, the standard form of economics, I hate calling it the mainstream, because that means that most of the people in this room are backwaters. I don't accept that. I'm not any damn backwater. The usual way of doing economics in the United States is called Samuelsonian economics, after its modern formulator. And his way of doing economics is to assume that everyone's max U. Max U in German. And max U maximizes utility subject to a constraint. He's prudent, to express it in another way. That's his only virtue, is prudence. And for some economic purposes, that's exactly right. That's what I teach in my price theory book, lots of my early work. Yeah, good. Max you. But if you're applying it to marriage or to politics, you're going to be misled if you think that the only virtue that people have is prudence. They also have love, justice, and temperance and courage, hope and faith. Now, Dan has this very interesting construction of joy. I guess I would have preferred to just call her God and have it done with it. But God in the image of humans. Humans in the image of God is the idea here. And his point is that in order to think in categories in a humanistic way, or in quantities in a scientific way, you have to have you have to imagine some mind looking at what's happening and judging it. And that kind of coordination, which he calls concatenation, is central to his argument. In a way, his book is a long lament for the point that Dan made at the end. A long lament for the loss of the theory of moral sentiments. Dan has a striking a passage in which he says, suppose we hadn't, by say 1820 in English and Scottish economics, lost the ethical program. Suppose we had kept that program that Adam Smith taught to his students, that he was explicit about, virtues, and he had a whole system of virtues as people who had argued over hundreds of years. What kind of, would we have lost liberalism by the end of the 19th century? I think it's an interesting point. It adds with all counterfactuals the problem that we call, if my grandmother had wheels, she'd be a tram, which is that if the world hadn't been the way it was in 1820, then it wouldn't have been the world it was in 1810 or 1800, back to the creation. It's very hard to imagine this counter factual, but it's a way of stressing, as Dan does throughout the book, the importance of ethical thinking in economics. It's terribly clear, and as Dan points out, it's become terribly clear in the last 30 years, that our master, Adam Smith, was a profoundly ethical thinker. And when he thought about prudence, his great book on prudence, what was the Wealth of Nations, he thought about prudence in a context with other virtues. And that's very much a project of, now, see if you can use the word in a sentence, humanomics. It's combining the insights of philosophy, and history, drama, and so forth, with the so-called scientific parts of economics. And in fact, his notion of joy as a, how can I say this, as a kind of a speculative maximizer, as a benevolent presence that says, oh yes, oh humans, you would be better off if you would see things the way I do. I think he's exactly historically accurate on this point, because there's a change in Christian archaeology in places like England and the United States, what became the United States, in the 18th century in Holland as well, which God becomes not a punisher, not so to speak a prudence-only provider of incentives, but a pet owner. She views all of us as her pets and wants our happiness. This is a quite distinct theological term. I suppose my only suggestion for the book and for the project, and I think Dan probably agrees with this, is to carry on the humanomics project right to the problem of language in the economy. There's something very strange about economics when you think about it. And this applies to Austrian economics and Marxist economics and Samsonian, any kind of economics that you want to think of almost, which is that a typical conversation is supposed to go like this. $3.50. Yes. End of conversation. It's a rather thin notion of connection between language and behavior, or language and happiness, or language and fulfillment. And I think language matters more than economists have acknowledged, and that a fully successful economic science would have not just the virtue of prudence, it would have all these other virtues I mentioned, and that Adam Smith thought very highly of, and would not just have information, it would have knowledge and persuasion, and above all, meaning. So I think Dan would agree that he's at the beginning of a glorious project. This book isn't, well, as Churchill famously said, we are not at the beginning of the end. We are not, we're not even at the, I can't quite remember it, but we are at the end of the beginning. This is a beginning of a project of a much broader economics, a much more human and humane economics of the sort that Adam Smith first launched. Thank you very much.
Recently with Jamie Galbraith, who I wouldn't normally agree that many things with, but he had a great line in there where he said, fresh water, salt water, who cares? As any good biologist knows, all the evolution takes place in the backwater. Right, so it's not a problem being in the backwater. Casey, are you going to handle that? Raise your hand, Casey will acknowledge you, and then address your questions to either Professor Klein or Professor McCloskey.
Humanomics.
Dan, would you discuss a little bit more of the market failure or the policy failure? you know, you discuss. Most businesses, of course, fail. And so how does that relate to your overall perspective? And Joy is always giving bad advice. 90% of the time.
Yeah, that's right. And is this okay? This is red here. So my battery, can you do that? The point of the allegory is not to say that, you know, everything works out perfectly. There's actually a few ways of organizing the world in some broad sense. There may not be that many focal points to choose from, and the principle of free markets and liberty is very central and very focal. That's not to say that when you have free markets, everything happens in a way where you never say Joy erred. Like you say, businesses are still going to make losses, but then it becomes comparative. If you have antitrust, if you have other interventions and controls, are you going to reduce the problems overall or increase them? And so, in some sense, I think we're making that comparison based on some very broad, as it were, aesthetic judgments. There could be parts of it, of course, that are fairly quantitative, and evidence could be quantitative. But when you put it all together, you're making something more in the loose, vague, and indeterminate type of judgment. And even in the best arrangement, there's going to be Joy doing things wrong, as it were. Although you could also tamper with your allegory and maybe say that this is back as some kind of constraint or something for Joy, but I don't know if that helps. Does that help?
Yeah, well, I was thinking about the creative destruction.
The creative destruction. That's something I talk about some, and I say that entrepreneurship often has that effect, and it upsets coordination in one sense of coordination, but generally enhances coordination in the other sense of coordination. It upsets mutual coordination. It may upset custom and habits and what had been people's focal points. But on the other hand, it advances concatenate coordination. Distinguishing these two coordinations is a big part of the book, actually. And so that's how I negotiate that issue about whether entrepreneurship enhances or disrupts coordination. I say, in one sense, this, in one sense, that.
Creative destruction, a phrase of Schmoller's that made famous, is a really central issue to the evaluation of, you might say, capitalism, democracy, and Ralph's Pretty Good Grocery, something like that. That'd be nice too. Because it's a contingent historical fact that the creativity of the modern world in the last couple of centuries has been good for us. It didn't have to work out that way. Some new ideas are bad ideas, even though quite successful. The invention of mustard gas in the First World War was a really bad idea. The invention of racial histories in the late 19th century and the corresponding invention of a whole public policy of eugenics in startling sounding places like Norway, which had the highest percentage of compulsory sterilization from the 1920s to the 1970s of any country in the world. So, and think of jazz. Some people view Charlie Parker as a catastrophe for jazz. And yet he and his school was commercially successful. Modern painting has not, on the whole, I think, been a success. Picasso was not a good idea. Women with two eyes on the side of their head just doesn't make it. But I nonetheless assert that in the economy where there is this market test, where on the whole it's worked damn well. Look around you. Everyone here, I take it, is descended from peasants. I don't see any descendants of the crowned heads of Europe, Asia, or Africa here. So this is just a long way of saying, it matters how we feel about what you call allegories. It matters politically, it matters for economic policy, it matters tremendously. Because it's in the allegories, by the way, I'm from the Department of English, I'm here to help you. And I don't think you've got the definition of that. I don't think you've got the definition of allegory exactly right. But that doesn't matter. What you're talking about is the role of leading figures of speech in thought. And they're bloody important.
Casey, there's also someone across the table.
Okay. My name is Joy, so I'm going to join us. I just have a question about the very brief conversation that Jared mentioned earlier. And I think that economists sometimes focus on things because they're easy to analyze, not necessarily because they're the most interesting.
You're telling me.
So how do we go forward and you take conversations that have depth and allegory and nuance, and how do we analyze those the way that we've been analyzing transaction prices and some of the more superficial actions that we've been looking at?
Well, by urging humanomics on people and saying, gee, the meaning of words matters, and you ought to take a more sophisticated view of language than, I don't know, that it's just the same as silent trade. Have you got any thoughts about that, Dan? How we could answer her question?
I'm afraid no.
Back to Joy because of the work some of the work you did with Bart Wilson and stuff, you know, where they're trying to examine those kind of things in the post-lab settings, right? That's one way. Another way, I think, is Deirdre's work, which is that economists should be doing detailed historical analysis with the aid of the theoretical lenses of economics. But that our task is, the purpose of theory is to do history, right? And we should get out there into the world and actually do history. Field work is another area, a lot of different things.
Yeah, but not just detailed historical analysis. I've done a lot of that in my life, detailed economic historical analysis. But what you said the magic word, and that illuminates it for me, namely Bart and Lou Wilson. Now I understand what you're asking, and I think that Bart has done fantastic work. And he and I, in fact, are working on a paper on humanomics, a paper on a conference on this, and in a way, completely unsurprisingly, as I said, we in the English department find this kind of obvious. Surprise, surprise, in an experimental situation with a bunch of undergraduates, if you allow them to talk to each other, particularly if they have meaningful talk, for example, scolding each other for not playing the game right, you get really different results. Meaning matters. People care, as you said, Dan, was it this afternoon or this evening? I can't remember, but about identity being important. say, that would be another part of a humanomics, taking identity more seriously than this kind of show of Max Hube. You know, all he does is Max Hube. He doesn't have many other qualities.
Say something about, is this okay?
Yeah.
Just about a little bit about conversation in my book. I make reference to the McCloskey idea of entrepreneurship as a rhetor, as a persuader, as a speaker, and an organizer. And I relate that to other ideas of entrepreneurship, for example, the idea of entrepreneurs bearing uncertainty as opposed to risk. Risk you could think of as a matter of settled interpretation, like we have a coin, we trust that it's a regular coin, and we have a flat, clear interpretation of our odds with a coin, whereas uncertainty is a matter of unsettled interpretation. And so I write some about how you need speech. You need to project the interpretation to your collaborators in the firm. And that's exactly the element of entrepreneurship that you're picking up on. And I see that as dovetailing with several of the other formulations of entrepreneurship.
Well, for example, codes and transactions codes.
Yeah. Anyhow.
Yeah. Don Drew. Actually, something you just said, Dan. Two points, really quickly, upgrading it earlier, private conversation, but not blogging about what's going on with the New Orleans Saints, those of you that the football team, whose coach has been suspended for the year. And I heard something recently, the past day or two, the reason people worry, people who like me love the Saints, right? They worry, they say, because Sean Payton, the coach, talks to his team like no other person can. And they're worried about when he's gone for the year, they can get anybody else, he's not going to talk to the team in the way that coach does. So to give him a McCloskey point. So I'm trying to think, what would George Stigler, when he's still alive, what would George, if you were sitting here, what would he say?
Idiots.
Let me play, I agree with all that, but let me play devil's advocate just a little bit. Stigler might say, look, Dan, you complain, you say that it was the loss of allegory, or whatever it's properly called, that contributed to the decline of liberalism and free markets. But look, who in the past 50 years has done more to resurrect respect for free markets than Milton Friedman? And Milton didn't engage in any of that silly allegory. Milton measured money supply. Milton used supply and demand curves to talk, to show what happens when prices are capped. Milton was a real scientist. I mean, he even wrote an essay on the virtues of positive economics. He wouldn't have had any trouble with all his rhetoric stuff. And so how can you defend your thesis given that the great example we have, at least in the past half century, of the resurrection of free market ideas in the mind of the general public is this great positive, self-proclaimed positive economist who celebrated numbers and measurements?
Well, I think it's real important to keep Stigler and Friedman distinct here. I could understand Stigler sitting here and hating the whole thing. See, what I did in my presentation is I suggested that this talk of cooperation, this talk of communication, and so on, depends on allegory. He might be ready to say, I don't care about that talk about cooperation. I don't care about that talk about communication. So if he's ready to throw all that away and keep it, drier and less meaningful and, the fact is, with Milton Friedman, though, he and Rose were among those I quoted on cooperation. So, in fact, he transcended the Stiglerian view and position, and we love him and celebrate him for that. But what I want to emphasize, I know my talk is like totally strange. It's not like I have this allegory idea, really well worked out. But honestly, the communication, what does it mean other than the allegory? It just doesn't work. literally, the cooperation, it just doesn't work. And the other examples gave as well. I think those figures of speech are important. And that's why Milton and Rose used them and had such great effect. And the problem was that the Stiglerian type of attitude sort of killed that.
So is it fair to say then that, in your view, Friedman was not really as dedicated to positive economics as he proclaimed when he wrote about methodology?
That's exactly correct.
Yes.
That's exactly correct. He didn't really carry out this program, Stigler, who once described with Murray Rothbard as a Stalinist. And Rothbard was outraged by this. He wrote to George and complained about this character McCluskey was calling him a Stalinist. And what it meant is that they were both prepared to go all the way in their views and were not prepared to tolerate any objections or contrary views, whereas Milton was always trying to talk to people. He tried to get the SDS, the Students for the Democratic Society, to debate him. Now they wisely wouldn't, because they knew they would lose. But he was much more open and humanistic in this academic sense, talking to
with Friedman. I think you always have this sense that actually liberty and liberalism is the overarching project.
That's right.
And you certainly don't have that with Stigler. In fact, he explicitly helped to subvert the proper definition of liberty. He did a lot. He was like the anti-Smith, George Stigler.
Anti-Christ.
It's kind of amazing, but if you make a list, or if you kind of spell out, like, you know, five salient features of Smithian economics, Stigler like made a point of attacking every one of those. Like, he flattened knowledge down to information. He subverted the definition of liberty. He was strongly positive, you know, normative positive distinction stuff.
He said that prudence is all that drives the wealth of nations. He says the wealth of nations was founded on the rock of self-interest.
Yeah.
Well, this is just not a very good reading.
Will Reinhardt, by the way. Professor Klein, you had a small chunk of one of these slides that said you can have a story of market error and correction without any agent error.
Right.
And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about this idea of agency and market, because often when you talk about the market, it's given this singular sense as though the market is this one unanimous thing, like as though it is a thing. And not necessarily a process. And when you look at, especially when you look at the most recent economic downturn, there is this kind of agency that's given to the market. The market did this is what the market did to us. You know, look at how the market's gone up or down. So I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit more about agency in a sense of kind of a singular market instead of more of a process, and how that kind of affects our way of looking at the market and our way of, applying policy then.
Yeah, I think we end up talking that way almost inevitably, and I don't think it's something that you should resist so much. I mean, we might talk about the process erring. And I think like Hayek in that 1933 quote about there being a function or sense to things. But he said, of course, it's not really an acting being, and we don't want to fall into the anthropomorphic error. But then he says, don't go throw it all away either, because if we do that, we lose exactly what I've been saying. These connotations, illusions, I don't know what the right word is, that we actually are primarily interested in the process. And so I think we do talk about stuff like market error, even though there is no Mr. Market or Boss Market or whatever. And again, I think ultimately we're maybe tacitly invoking some kind of allegory.
We can't do science without stories and metaphors. They aren't optional. Models are metaphors. Maybe you other people can see it, but I don't see any demand curve for housing in the sky over Fairfax County. But I know that there's a demand curve. I've been arguing this for a long time, about 30 years. There's a very fine book by the historian of science, Nancy Cartwright, old book of hers, called How the Laws of Physics Lie. And it's a joke, which depends on the English ambiguity in the word lie. And her point is that all physical laws are lies in the same way that a metaphor is a lie. So the only issue, that doesn't mean that we, you know, it's time to forget about truth and how you feel about the law of demand this afternoon. But it means that we humans use language. That's what we do. And science is a form of talking. And there's no non-talking way of doing science. So there's no non-metaphorical, non-narrative way of doing science. And you only fool yourself, and this is Dan's point, if you keep saying, oh no, I want to be literal. There's no there. That's a foolish attempt to get outside of language while speaking language.
I mean, if I could say something, I think that one of the great points that you emphasized in that earlier work and continues to come through is that even the most high form of formalists engage in this rhetoric.
Constantly.
Right? So Stigler, for example,
yep.
Right, was a master rhetorician.
You bet he was.
Within the context of that idea.
Yes.
And
yes.
So I mean, in the story that Stigler might tell, so in his Memoirs of an Unregulated Economist, he gets a letter from Talon Koopmans, who's upset because he believes that Stigler had argued during the height of World War II that if New York City was bombed, that you should use the price system to allocate the resources during the evacuation.
Yeah.
And Stigler writes back to Koopmans and says, Dear Talon, no, I did not, you know, write such a proposal. However, on second thought, it explains why the price system would be the most flexible thing. And so to go back to Don's question, which I think is maybe a challenge to both of you, let me put this in the way that I, using the New Orleans Saints example, I leaned over and mentioned this to Deirdre when you were talking, but one way that Stigler would say is you say the loss is that Sean Payton's not going to be able to talk to them. One of the answers that might come from a hard-boiled economist is that you just would have to set the price of the bounty the right way, right? And what Sean Payton's great thing was is that he and his staff set the bounty the right way, at least against the Minnesota Vikings or whatever, you know, when they put Brett Favre out of the thing. And so how is it that story, that metaphor, and all the stuff that goes in that, which is an incentive prudence-only story, how is it that the storytelling that, how does a richer notion of knowledge defeat a flatter notion of knowledge in the storytelling we do as economists? And that is part of the theme of your book, championing that idea.
Yeah, well, one answer is to start being ashamed of telling such dumb stories, but I don't know if we can get people to sign under the rug. Well, we tell the journalists and the politicians that they're telling dumb stories, but our way of telling them that they're telling dumb stories is to tell equally dumb stories. And we got to do better than that. We have to do something more sophisticated.
So you're asking, what are the problems with
disadvantages of flattening knowledge down to information?
Well, or the opposite way. So since you and I basically agree the same view, that knowledge should be this richer view, but the profession in which we live in seems to be much more comfortable with flat views of knowledge.
Right.
So they're telling a story, we follow Deirdre, they're telling a story, we're telling a story about richer knowledge, they're telling a story utilizing flat knowledge. What do we use to adjudicate between those two stories so that our story is more accepted rather than the one that's here? What would you think are the pivotal kind of ideas?
I think it can be helpful to give examples where what seems to matter in terms of knowledge or knowledge differences is not information, but is interpretation or judgment.
Yeah.
And just using those examples, I got some in the book, I got quite a few in the book, helps people to see that knowledge is not just a matter of information. And then basically what I see myself doing is trying to give some arguments about why this is worth worrying about because of the hazards of flattening knowledge down to information. I'd say both in terms of our understanding, for example, with respect to entrepreneurship and discovery, but also especially with respect to policy, okay, and politics. Because after all, the way that Donald Whitman argued that democracy is efficient was by flattening knowledge down to information, which was, in a sense, exactly what Brian called him on, by saying, look, the problem is not informational, but as Brian puts it, rational versus irrational, but I would say, you know, people not having good interpretations. If you flatten knowledge down to information, then it does suggest that the voter is, you know, fit to judge, to use Smith's expression there, and he can cue off other people with the right preferences, right? Like, oh, I have my preferences, and you know, I'll look to somebody who tells me what I should therefore vote for, and Whitman's argument goes through. But the problem is that people have wrong interpretations, even systematically wrong interpretations. So it matters a lot, I think, in policy and politics. I think it matters also in policy because if you flatten knowledge down to information, it kind of presupposes, you might recognize that there's a cost to search and so on, but it presupposes knowledge of the boxes to search over, and it suggests that the government is in a position to manipulate incentives so as to make the system work better, right? It's just a flat informational system. It's not like a whole question of disjointed knowledge with different interpretations and people having to learn to exercise judgment and all that. So I think some of the interventionist argumentation in some sense sounds better when you think of knowledge as merely information.
It seems a lot of the misinformation straw man that's out in society today, at least, is this sort of Max Huber document Boston refers to. And I think it sort of starts with the intro classes that we teach. Sometimes we just rely so much on price theory, neoclassical price theory, and people who really don't get what is trying to be taught, they seem to walk away from the classes thinking to themselves, well, just like Dr. Kulski referred to earlier, it's all about Max Huber. So I'm wondering, and this question is for both Dr. Kulski and Dr. Becky, what role price theory has going forward in the future, or what economists can do to better expose knowledge of the proper ascertaining of information, supply and demand curves, partial economic analysis, stuff such as that.
You ask a question that I'm vitally interested in. During these months, I and the graduate students at UIC are trying to revise my old The Applied Theory of Price, which last came out in 1985, the market test and all that, creative destruction. And since 1985, my views have, evolved a bit. And yet, I don't want to throw out the prudence-only arguments, because in some cases, they're exactly and only what you need. If you're going to study covered interest arbitrage in the foreign exchange markets, I advise you not to introduce love. Whereas if you're going to discuss, you know, voting, then you should include faith, thinking of faith as identity, and you should include hope. And the project of changing my book, I've come to realize, is a major research project in humanomics. So I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm going to sort of introduce a few little humanomics boxes, I guess. I don't know what to do.
I mean, it depends on which moment of the day that you ask me, but basically because I was a pretty good student back in the 1980s, and one of the books that I learned from was The Applied Theory of Price, and liked the book a lot and learned that there was all kinds of adjustments on margins. For example, the minimum wage discussion in your book, which was unique at the time because it didn't just view it on one margin, but instead how all other margins in fact are affected, and that economics is about relative prices and the adjustments that does. That I still think that we can't tell these stories that we want to tell without a price theoretic foundation to those stories. So I'm old fashioned, I guess, in that regard. I had a student last semester say that Professor Benke believes in the old economics. And they meant that as a criticism. And I like regale, yes, I believe in the old economics and you believe in bad economics. So I would say the only economics is relative price economics. Though I completely agree with both Dan and Deirdre here that we can't flatten knowledge. That's a huge mistake, and we can't treat it only as every problem is our, in another manifestation, you say our Jewish Korean friend,
right.
Max Hu.
Yeah. Right.
So, which I like better than the German one. It's just because I'm
Max Spoon.
Yeah. So. But anyway, Dan teaches, I teach a course called Economics for the Citizen. I try to teach about property prices and profit and loss. Right? Dan teaches principles of economics. You still teach principles of economics.
Not lately.
But you used to. And you try to communicate, sort of basic logic of economics. So I don't think that humanomics forces us to lose the logic of economics.
No, here's how I would say it. Look. The prudence part of human behavior, that virtue, the virtue of prudence, is what price theory is about. As you, I agree with you. But there, I don't think I agree with it, Pete. I don't think that we have to do prudence only just because we're economists. I don't accept that specialization.
Critics of capitalism often use the allegories either directly as part of their criticism, or it seems like that their interpretation of it through the allegories seems to be their misconceptualization, particularly with this Smithian type invisible hand and stuff like that. So how can we use the allegories to communicate accurately the message? On the individual level, and it's not some systems, some, like the polarizing institutions kind of confusing.
I think that thinking about something like what I was saying about this joy type of allegory, it can help. If you want to talk about the market system as cooperation, if you want to talk about communication, the price system and the market system, form of communication, which I'm very strongly in favor of. Like I said, it leads us to ask all of those questions in that communication way of speaking, which are great questions.
think you should do that and do that, as it were, knowingly, aware that you're calling upon something like this allegory, and not like hide it, not be afraid of it, not be ashamed of it, not deny it. But I'm not sure that I've got some particularly better way to do, you know, what Milton Rose Friedman were doing or what Hayek was doing. But do it confidently and knowingly. If you then turn around and sort of deny allegory and things like that, people can then start saying, well, what is this communication you're talking about? What is this cooperation you're talking about? You're trying to have it both ways. So it's better to just know what you're up to, if that makes sense.
We have a lot of very good spokespeople now for real liberalism. A number of them are in this room, for example, Don Boudreau. And they know that science and policy are matters of story and metaphor. It's no shock to them. In fact, when I argue with my Marxist friends, as I frequently do, they tend to be rather literal-minded about their scientific propositions. When I say, you know, there actually isn't any tendency of capitalism to collapse, which, if you think it through, is a highly metaphorical construct of something collapsing. They say, oh, no, they get very mad, and they say, look, the facts are obvious. It isn't clear that capitalism is collapsing. And I say to them, you've been saying this since 1857.
This will be the last question.
Professor Fine and Professor Hrabowski, I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit on the counterfactual of the theory of moral sentiments being lost in the early 1800s in sort of the classical liberal perspective, and kind of elaborate on how you think the loss of virtues besides prudence in economic discussion may have led to classical liberalism sort of losing out by the end of the 18th century. Sort of just kind of string that a little bit. How do you see that playing out? Why do you think that happened? And how do you think we can bring it back today to try to make classical liberalism a more compelling point of view?
I'll give you the last word, Dan, because I think Dan illuminates this very interestingly in the book. And I think there is this tragedy of the loss of confidence in capitalism, which happens after 1848. The sad story is that that economic growth, although it did start it and was clearly transforming a country like Britain in 1800, it didn't much increase the evident welfare of the ordinary person very much until after the middle of the 19th century. And that was just too late. If it had come, this is another alternate kind of factual. If it had come 20 years earlier, the socialism that came out of 1848, although Europe would not have perhaps have prospered. But ideologies are persistent and tough often. And what's odd about the case that Dan is talking about is that a liberal ideology, a birthing in the late 18th century, early 19th century, sort of ran into the sand. It was very strange, and I think I haven't ever understood why ethical thinking in the West changed so sharply in the late 18th century. You had Kant and you had Bentham. One justice is everything, the other encompasses everything. And they took over ethical discussion, which for 2,000, over 2,000 years in the West, had been about virtues. I have an essay called Adam Smith, the Last of the Former Virtue Ethicists, because thinking of virtues in ethical, well, it seems very odd to speak this way, but thinking of ethics in terms of virtues more or less stopped cold around 1800. So there was a kind of failure of the birth of liberalism, a hard coming we had of it. So now it's our responsibility in this room to think through the ethics, economics, politics of a free society in a serious way that can get us back on track. I think, as Don just said, I think these great figures like Hayek and Friedman were marvelous revivers of this program, but it's our duty as the next and succeeding generations to extend it, make it more sophisticated than our friends on the left, make it stronger empirically than our friends on the left, make it stronger ethically and emotionally than our friends on the left.
Yeah, that's a really great question, Paul, and I don't have any good answer or easy answer. Why did TMS fall into oblivion? That's the main part of the question. And also maybe, what if it hadn't? I don't really know why it fell into oblivion. I mean, you can kind of read a lot of the commentators at the time. There's a very nice collection by John Reeder, Adam Smith's Moral Sentiments, Contemporary Reactions, which has collected a lot of those, including stuff that wasn't published until later, or even at all, really widely. And so you can read that and kind of see people being uncomfortable with things in the Theory of Moral Sentiments. And the Theory of Moral Sentiments is an extremely mysterious work. So in that sense, it's not surprising. There's a mystery in it, which I don't think are tackled at all. I think even very central things about it, which are not well grasped or understood or interpreted. So in that respect, it's maybe not so surprising that people sort of didn't get it and left it behind. There is this deeply allegorical thing to it with the impartial spectator and all of this loose, vague, and indeterminate aspect of it, like inherently so. And it could be something to the effect that as intellectuals grew more, as it were, professional and specialized, that didn't sit well with them. I'm not sure if it's maybe a little early to be invoking that kind of explanation, but at least later that would make more sense. I don't know. I really, it's a very tough one. Okay. I want to thank the Mercatus Center and Claire Morgan and the staff for doing all the work that they did for this. I want to point out to all of you that this book is available outside, and I'm sure Dan might even sign some copies. He came up to it and said, he's a nice author. He's not going to bite you or anything. 50% off, so that's
fine.
The VR machine was and I want to thank all of you for coming out, and most importantly, to thank Deirdre and Dan for coming here, and I wish you all the best with this book. Thank you.